Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Can you close back from the back corner there? They don't have any chairs. Can you just want to come up the wall a little bit and just make yourself comfortable and block the exit? That would be great. Good evening. My name is John McLean, and I'm the director of the Emergency Operations Center for the Regional District of Calgary. We're here tonight to give you a little bit of information, as much information as you can, about the fire situation that we're facing in the south. We have a lot of friends from Wildfire Management Branch, the Office of Fire Commissioner, Ministry of Transportation, and we're all working together to ensure that we can get through this little episode as safe as we can. So there's a few people that we're going to ask to come up and say just a couple words as we get started. And I'd like to start with His Worship, Frank Conrad, the Mayor of Grand Forks.
Good evening, everyone. Just by the amount of people here, I can see there's concerns and a lot of questions that you want to have answered. We're surrounded by great groups of people here, John, and all the other groups. We're acting as proactively as we can under every circumstance. So all I can stress to you all, air of calm. Don't let your anxiety run away with you. We're in good hands.
Thank you very much. Now I'd like to ask Roly Russell, the area director.
Everybody for showing up tonight. Just a couple quick comments. I wanted to commend the Emergency Operations Center. They've been doing a lot of good work and encourage people again using, there's a lot of action on social media, encouraging you again to go to the RDKB.com website in order to get that information and make sure that we're conveying the correct information out to people. So again, thanks to the EOC and all the energy that's gone into keeping us safe. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, I'd like to ask Chair Grace McGregor to come up.
We can reach out to almost everyone. Please, please stay calm, but be vigilant. You need to make sure that you check your emails, your radio, everything. Think about the 5 P's in your house when you're wandering around, and you know what those are, right? They're pets and people and papers and prescriptions and pictures, and the sixth is personal computers. So keep that in mind. We'll be able to see you later tonight also. So please, thank you very much for being here, and give a big round of applause to our EOC people.
Thank you very much. As Chair McGregor alluded, we do have another meeting tonight. We're going to go to Christina Lake and have the same show for those folks. So I'm going to tell you right now, 7:20, we're out of here. Okay, just everybody know, at 7:20 we're going to go. We're going to do the same thing for those folks over there. So there's a whole bunch of people here, everyone's working. There's just one other person that I want to mention. Without his efforts in this community, we'd have a lot more problems than we have. And he's hiding in the back, and he's not in uniform tonight, but Chief Dale Harriet's here. I can assure you, you're in good hands. So, our first speaker tonight, I'm going to ask Alvin Boyer, local representative for Ministry of Forces, to come up and give you a little bit of a snapshot of what we're facing here in the zone. Alvin?
My name is Alvin Boyer. I'm the Force Protection Officer for the Boundary Fire Zone. And I wanted to give a perspective of what we've been up against this summer. And really the summer for us has really started at the end of June, around June 28th. Since around there, we've got 136 wildfires to date. Our average here in the Boundary Fire Zone is 35 fires a year. So you can see the magnitude we've been dealing with, and you guys all know how dry the conditions are here. The other record year we have had here is 132 wildfires, and that was in 1994, and that was the highest ever that I can find in history. In the past week alone, we've had 41 wildfires start since last Thursday, and so it's taxed our zone and our fire center and the province big time to keep on top of these. So a lot of you have seen smoke. We've had to prioritize fires as we fight them to hit the fires that are affecting people and property firstly and in the front country. Right now we have 18 wildfires burning within the zone. And some of the fires of note are the Rock Creek Fire, 4,200 hectares. Paulson Pass Fire, 300 hectares. Lynch Creek, 85 hectares. Lynch Creek West Fire, 25. A fire near Joan Lake, west of Beaverdale, 70 hectares. And Tenderloin Creek, 45 hectares. I should have explained the zone boundaries. I apologize here. So we go from the west side, from the Anacus Summit. The east side of the zone is the Paulson Pass area, and then we go about as far north as Big White and Lightning Peaks, kind of south of, I forget the name of the community, sorry, it's my nervousness here. The resources we have in the zone right now, we roughly have 124 firefighting staff in Grand Forks at this time, 11 helicopters, and about 15 pieces of heavy equipment on fires. Also, the Rock Creek Complex, we're operating that separately with an incident management team. They roughly, and this is very roughly, have about 150 people, another 11 aircraft, and 15 pieces of equipment working. So there is a lot of activity that we haven't experienced here for a long time, let alone the fire that is we're going to be speaking about that is in the United States right adjacent to the borders here. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Alvin. I'd now like to ask Tony Buffalo, the incident commander, to come up and have a chat about what we're facing.
Good evening, everyone. Anybody hear me okay? So I just coming IC. I just arrived earlier this morning, and it's been a pretty busy day. So I'll try to do my best to paint a picture of what's going on south of the border and what we're planning moving forward. So I want to just start off real quickly with just a brief snapshot of the weather, short term and going out 3 or 4 days. So our forecasters are saying that tonight we're going to get winds. The winds are going to be out of the south, southwest, anywhere from 15, perhaps 30. That's not a good direction for us. Okay, it's going to do that all through the evening. Sometime mid-morning, it's going to switch around and start coming out of the north-northwest, which is good for us. Now, as far as distances from the fire to the border, okay, so just south of Grand Forks, it's about 4.5 kilometers to the border crossing, the border itself. Towards Christina Lake, and if you take that angle of approach, it's about 12.5 kilometers. Now, it hasn't moved very much in the last few days for a couple of reasons. Basically, one large reason is because of the old fire that it's run into south of town here. I forget the name of it. Thank you. But anyways, that's really good for us. It's really kind of just slowed that sucker right down, and it's looking really good there. Now, on the other side there, the fire's a lot more active, and it has been kind of been hidden away from the wind, but now, you know, we're starting to get wind slope and aspect alignment, so we expect the fire to grow. So that means, you know, more fire activity. We're going to see a lot more smoke in town, and even perhaps a lot of ash falling out of the sky. We went down there today and met with our counterparts in the U.S. and got a really good sense about what they're doing on the fire. They also are experiencing a very significant fire year. They're incredibly stretched for resources. There just isn't any extra resources available. But on the fire, I'll just give you a quick update on that. So basically, on the west side of the fire, okay, they've done some really good work there. They've actually, what they've called, they've blackened it. They put in lines and they burned off from there. So that side of the fire is looking pretty well. Coming around the top, the north side of the fire, they just started to get in there today with a dozer line, and that's through the old burn. Pretty confident that they're going to get around there. However, the entire east flank of the fire has received no action. There simply isn't resources, and it's been a bit dangerous to put people in there, and also the terrain makes it very difficult. It's very steep, very inaccessible. However, as it does burn down, it gets into more operable ground. There's road networks that we can use to work from, etc. Now, moving ahead, we've put a concept out there that we really have to kind of work out all the details yet. But basically, what it means is putting Canadian boots on the ground on that side of the border to protect our values on this side of the border. So that concept has been. It's a lot easier to say that than to actually govern bureaucracy. But anyways, we'll leave it at that. But moving forward, you know, we're going to have Canadians on that side of the border integrated with the management team, and we're going to be working together on it. It's a win-win situation, and, you know, I'm optimistic with the whole thing. Now, of course, you know, our chances of success, honestly, rely on Mother Nature and what she throws at us. The long-term forecast after the winds is for back to hot and dry, kind of what you've been experiencing, but no wind, so a bit more stable environment. And then long-term, you know, for what it's worth, they're calling for cooler and perhaps wetter weather. But at 7 days out, who knows what's going to happen. In preparation for all this, we're doing a whole bunch of things. We've got approval from management to go ahead with the concept, so we're going to go, we're going to start planning really hard and really need resources to do what we have to do. In the meantime, you know, we've done a lot of strategic planning as far as contingency lines, trigger points for alerts, evacuations. We hope to have all that kind of sorted out sometime tonight, and then we'll communicate that to the local government, and then that'll be communicated out to the public. I think that's about it. It's been a really busy day, and I expect it to be busy for the next couple of weeks. We've got a lot of really good resources incoming. We know we've got a good plan moving forward, and just hope everything works out for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, IC Culper. So this is the first part of the planning process that we're in. Now I'm going to ask Gord Parker to come up, and we're going to talk a little bit about structural protection and what we're doing on that behalf. So, Gord.
Thank you. Is this loud enough for everybody? I'm with the Office of the Fire Commissioner, and I'm a structure protection specialist. I'm one of a few structure protection specialists that are here tonight. Our role is to plan and assess structures whenever there's a wildfire that's potentially threatening. We bring a little bit of extra resource to the playing field as well. We bring sprinkler protection units that we may be getting up on structures as well to help protect them. One of our main roles is to work with your local departments, and we've been working with Grand Forks, Christina Lake, and the Regional District Fire Department to help plan for fire department response and to look for ways where we can support the local departments as well. So, we're moving forward. What you're going to see from us potentially in the community is we have crews out there now. We're going through neighborhoods. We're assessing neighborhoods. We're looking for water supplies. We're looking to help create that plan should that fire come into the neighborhood. And ultimately, hopefully, it's going to help us best defend the community. I think, we're working hard now with the various departments. We're getting great cooperation. We're getting great cooperation from the Wildfire Management Brand and, of course, the ERC. And we're going to be working hard. We're going to be diligently moving forward with a lot of the departments and moving forward with this. And, I'm hoping to have a really successful outcome out of this. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Now it's actually my turn to talk. So in terms of what the Emergency Operations Center is doing and what we're working on right now. So we're in constant communication with Southeast Fire, Wildfire Management Branch, the Office of the Fire Commissioner, with our fire services in Grand Forks, Christina Lake. We're talking to our neighbors in Central Kootenai and beyond to talk about if worst comes to worst, and we need to bring in equipment, or we can access that equipment, where we're going to deploy it, how we're going to use it. We're doing our staffing plans to make sure that we have people that are ready to help you folks if something happens, if the fire comes across the line. So we're all very much hoping that that doesn't happen, but we're preparing for that eventuality. So, in terms of evacuations, because that's going to be one of the things that are always going to be talked about, we have a two-stage process in Canada and BC. We have an evacuation alert, and we have an evacuation order. There have been no alerts, there have been no orders issued. We are not at that point yet. If we issue an evacuation alert, it'll be a warning. It'll be, okay, folks, if you're in this area, pack a bag. Follow Chairman McGregor's advice, get your papers, get your passports, get your important pictures, have them next to the door. If we come the next time, it'll be an evacuation order, and we'll be asking them to leave. We do plan and prepare for all eventualities. If you have livestock, we have the Ministry of Agriculture come in and help us. If you have special needs, we will address those. We plan for these eventualities. So, folks, the people that we're going to be talking to, if the need arises, and only if the need arises, are the people on the south. So Carson Road in this community, down towards the river, down towards border. As you heard from IC Falco, the northern end of this fire is looking not too bad. So that's the major impact there. Over in Christina Lake, we've got a slightly different issue, and we're going to be talking to them in an hour. All we can say is that we are preparing, we are planning, we are trying to do everything we can to ensure that if we have to ask you folks to go, that you can do so in a safe manner. A few things I'm going to tell you right now. If we ask you to go, you're going east. Okay? You're going east. You're going to Castlegar, Nelson, actually you're going to Trail. That's where reception will be, is in Trail. Reason being, in case you didn't hear it, there was a big old fire just a little bit west here. And once you get a little bit further west, you get into Okanagan. and there ain't a hotel room there to be had. So so if our plan to go east, so part of that planning process is having a long, meaningful conversation with the friends of Minister of Transportation who are here today about making sure the highway 3 is open. So we're all working on that. So there's a few other things that we should talk about. Have your stuff ready if you're in that southern zone. Don't clog up 911 and fire dispatch. We all know it's smoky. We heard that it's going to stay smoky. I know for a fact that here in the city of Grand Forks, the rural Grand Forks, the fire department's going to be on patrol tonight, watching for embers, watching for ash, watching for spots. We'll catch up. We're going to do our level best to make sure that everybody stays safe and has a home to come back to. That's our job. So, a few other things you just want to share, just in case you're planning on traveling anywhere, is that no matter which way you go on Highway 3, you're going to drive through a little bit of a burned out area, either up on Paulson or in Wapro Creek, West Virginia. There's going to be debris on the roads. There's going to be pine, what hasn't burnt. There's going to be ash. There's going to be dust. There's going to be speed restrictions. You're going to have to face that. We're working very, very hard to get Highway 33 up to Kelowna. We're hoping to get that done next couple days. So I see a lot of folks fanning themselves with pieces of paper that we put out on the back table. That's wonderful. That's some information on how you can prepare your home, how you can prepare in case we need to ask you to leave. Folks, I need to make this really, really clear to you. If we come up and knock on your door and say the fire's coming, you got to go. You got to go. Okay? I can't force you. I can't take you away in handcuffs. But if you choose to stay, I can't help you. Okay? I want to make that very, very, very clear. We will not put our people at risk if someone refuses to go when we can do it. Okay? Now, we were really, really awesome and got it done. If everyone promises not to get too excited, we'll take a couple questions. I'm going to answer this, but I think they have pretty much anything they need.
Unfortunately, the border that's between us and the fire put some bureaucracy in there. However, like I said, we've worked our way through that, and now moving forward, we'll be in a position to utilize our resources, including aircraft, south of the border.
Can you get to the States through 395? Right now, yes. If worst case scenario comes up, that's the area that we're worried about. So if it comes up, that southwest corner, quite honestly, that's the area we're concerned about. Lynch Creek, does anybody know about Lynch Creek? Alvin? Oh, here we go.
I don't have all the information you'd want on Lynch Creek, but I will tell you it is 85 hectares. We were finally able to put crews on there. I believe it was only yesterday. There is another fire in the Lynch Creek area, just a little west of there. It's somewhere around 10 hectares as well. We have a crew as well on there now. But those fires, yeah, they're very big for the crews we have right now, and so we'll be doing some limited action, but you can expect that those fires could get larger, and we'll see smoke there likely a while until we can get a handle on it.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
If you issue an alert, how will we get that?
If we issue an alert, an order will knock on your door. Yes, ma'am. Okay, and that is fine if you can get through. The issue is that we won't be able to support you because you won't be able to register. Okay. So part of the reason you go to trail, you go to a single spot, is to register. Then we know where you are. But if you have family you can go and you're happy, we're fine with that.
Okay, so the registration is just okay, but it's fine with my community.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
What is the best internet or Facebook site to get the absolute quickest up-to-date info?
RDKB.com and Twitter. Nothing on Facebook.
Because we were looking at that today and there was really nothing until the announcement about this meeting.
Yes, sir, and we just had our meeting, so you got the information about 10 minutes after meeting.
The Ferry County Sheriff's Facebook and the Ferry County View Facebook's got updates every 20 minutes. So is there an equivalent here, I guess?
No.
Okay.
I got to go over here because we hit this side a few times. Go ahead now. The question was, has there been any discussion about calling the forces? Not yet. Sir?
Just a little concerned about the elderly over at the villages and the hospitals, like regarding air quality. Would there be a special alert like for people like that?
IHA has been putting out air quality statements due to the smoke for about the last day. Those alerts are already out there. We have those concerns. Yes, ma'am, you aren't sure. Seeing that glow and starting to get really excited, sometimes that glow is pretty far away. Folks, we'll do our best. We will do our level best. That's my promise to you. As soon as we have that information, we'll open it. Yes, ma'am.
Will there be a means of volunteers assisting you? I'm sure that if you're having to go door to door, it's going to be pretty difficult with all of you working so hard at your immediate task. Will there be a means of gathering names for such an event?
Yes. Sorry. You guys could have filled in any question you wanted. The question was, will there be a means for people to identify when they want to volunteer? And the answer is yes. Not there yet. But there will be a means. Yes, ma'am.
Do you have a media person in place for this specific area so that we can get information in real time? Because honestly, at this moment, we haven't. That's why we're here. So I mean, in real time on the radio, or really because people don't have computers. So, and I mean, it's not just the fire and the lot waiting for the flames. There's a lot of potholes and ash. So like you said, things can happen very quickly. So do you have enough physical people on the ground or not on every door? Or should those who are capable maybe consider being up?
So the question was a couple different parts. Do we have someone here that can keep the media informed on an ongoing basis, on a real-time basis, so we get information to you? We don't have a media person. I do have staff that are dedicated to that purpose. And we have called in more staff. And we'll call in the resources we need to get the information to you. The second question was, do we have enough resources available to knock on the doors? The answer to that question is yes. Yes. if you're not home, there will be a note on your door. So, a couple other things that I want to tell you. If you are in an evacuation alert area, if we get to that point and we knock on your door and say, be ready, you're warned. It's only a warning. We will start doing structure protection at that point. So we will ask Gordon McGray and his team from the Office of Fire Commissioner start putting up the sprinklers, starting pre-positioning all the equipment, so just in case it comes in. So I don't want anyone to start getting flanged if that happens. I will already knock on your door and say, hey guys, guess what? It's coming. Okay, so I want you to know that. We're getting pretty close to the end of our time. I'm going to take one more question. I'm going to let Chairman McGregor go.
Okay, I've heard on the radio that there was people breaking into homes in Rock Creek that were being evacuated. What is going to be done here if you have to evacuate to keep them out?
We heard the same reports. I'm not sure that we ever received any substantiated reports on the Rock Creek fire. I just didn't receive them. They might happen, don't know. That is part of our planning process. We've already involved the RCMP that if we have to ask folks to leave the neighborhood, that we put the security up. That is part of our role. Yes, ma'am.
Would it be possible to have more communication through either CBC or the trail radio station, or more often communication on this? Because a lot of the people don't have computers, especially the elderly, they listen to the radio, and it hasn't been, I feel, enough information.
Thank you very much. So the question was, can we do more through radio using CBC or the other radio stations to get permission to folks? The answer to the question is yes. We are going to use every source we can think of to get information to you. Unfortunately, we don't control those people, so we give the information, they choose not to report it, we can't do anything about that. But we will give them the information. Yes, and I'll publish it. The question was, if you leave town, go on vacation, and if you do, great, go somewhere where there's no smoke. Is there somewhere you should call to say, hey, I'm out of town, if I can come home, let me know? Yes, we'll publish that and let you know what that number is. So I'm going to ask Jeremy Green.
I just wanted you to stress the importance of registering so
yes.
You know those people
are out of there. So Jeremy Greger's telling you to say something, and she's my boss, so I'm going to do it. Folks, it goes back to Lee's comment about if she went back to Kelowna because that's where her family is. By all means, if you go to your family and you're comfortable there, that's fine. Just know that we don't know where you are. That's all we're going to say is we can't support you. However, if we ask you to leave, go to the registration center, get your vouchers, register, give us the contact information you're going. Even if you're going from there to your family, that's perfect. That's wonderful. That's great. It works really, really well. So that's what registration is about, is when we can offer you support. We have a really good support team, and they just have a whole lot of practice. So we're getting not too bad at it. So, folks, I think I'm going to shut it down now. We've got a couple minutes, and we make our way to the door. If you have some individual questions for any of us, please let us know. My promise to you is that we'll get as much information to you as we can. Stay calm. Thank you very much.